Let's get something very big also into the conversation. We'll talk about development finance, of course, the dealing room, getting big ticket, bankable transactions or infrastructure transactions in Africa together, and putting the policymakers, the government, the businesses, and those who have the deep pocket together to put this money on the table and fast track development challenges across the continent. The man who is sitting down here to discuss with his Kola Oyinnayin, who is the founder and chief executive officer at Banco Leonela, Development Finance Expert, and was in love with the MSME. That was SME. This is bigger.
This is
much, much bigger.
Yes.
Yes. So this is big, much bigger than MSME. So sorry, folks. This is big money, multi-million dollars.
Yes.
So in terms of where do you think finance solutions for Africa development is very key? But again, what do you consider as a major challenge here?
I think the biggest challenge we have is capacity. It's not the unavailability of money; it's the capacity to develop these projects and ensure that they are bankable. So when we have conversations with development finance organizations from the World Bank to IMF to Africa Development Bank, everybody's sitting on pocket loads of money that they are willing to put into infrastructure financing or to even for Afrexim, which is looking at trade, to put into big ticket transactions. The question has always been, African projects are not bankable. They do not make economic sense.
How come with all of you, folks like you with big brains, well-developed, well-trained, well-schooled, we don't have projects that are bankable?
So I think the first mistake we've made as a continent, and let me use Nigeria as a classic example, is the fact that we have not staffed our ministries with the right skill sets to be able to make infrastructure enticing to the private sector. So we have always treated infrastructure and financing of big ticket transactions as something that stays with the remit of the government. But we know that even with all the budget deficits and everything, that government alone cannot be able to finance infrastructure. As a matter of fact, the concept of government financing infrastructure is as archaic as probably 200 years now, because developed in the developed world, from America to Europe to Australia, they've been practicing private partnerships, whether it's road, whether it's airport, whether it's industry, bringing private finance into the conversation. So on one hand, you have development finance institutions saying annually that we are sitting on $6 trillion USD that we're willing to give to countries, to projects that are bankable. On the other hand, you have something within the private finance that is called dry powder, that is about $63 billion a year, that is sitting there looking for projects that are bankable. So the question then is, what is bankability?
So structural deficiency here from the planning stages.
Yes.
Every year we do trillions in Naira, and if you continue to use Nigeria as a classic case of road, bridges, airports, what have you, refineries, and we keep not getting it right. So do you think putting everybody in the room, government officials, policymakers, I mean the MDAs, folks who are in the PAMSECs or directors, whatever, with the deep pocket, we'll be able to say, look, these are the fault lines in the way you designed, or you think Lagos about a highway or the second Niger Bridge or whatever Lagos kind of rail line should work. There's a problem here. I can't put my money on it because this doesn't meet my financing objectives and criteria.
Absolutely. But the beauty of this is that this conversation cannot be a one-off conversation. To change a continent or to change a country and the way in which it works cannot be a one-off conversation. And that is why we have something called the 10-year strategic plan for Africa's infrastructure. We want to have this conversation, we want to keep this conversation ongoing for the next 10 years. Because if you're talking about capacity development within the front-end planning of projects, we want to be able to say, once we bring all these policymakers, all these deep pockets, we begin to look at best practices and how this projects should be structured. One of the things we are doing in DFS Africa is to partner with MDAs and help them to develop what we call the PPU, which is the private partnership unit within MDAs, to begin to curate what we call the next generation of deal pipelines for them. And one of the things we would also do for them is that we would expose these deal pipelines to development finance institutions and private finance, who will be able to give equity, and development finance will give loan. So I think over the next couple of years, you will begin to see the fruit of this new approach that is a lot more collaborative and bringing the principal stakeholders together to have the conversation about how to change our existing practices.
Yeah, that sounds sweet to my ears.
But it's a lot of work.
Yes, it is. Again, because I know it's a lot of work, because if you're talking to MDAs that are traditionally civil service, public service in nature, to sit next to the next office, yeah, where you now have folks who are
slightly different.
Slightly different. Let's just put it very nicely. So they kind of cohabit, as yeah, it were, yes, co-work together, yeah, to say, look, we're going to design a new, what you call, Lagos-Calabar highway,
yeah,
across the ocean, right?
Yeah.
Sorry, across the beach, yeah, the sea line, and all the way down, hundreds of kilometers all the way. Yeah. You need guys, therefore, who are traditionally civil servant, who will push the papers.
Yeah.
But again, you're talking about a few guys,
yeah,
sitting next to them.
Okay, so yeah, so the biggest challenge we would face with the PPU is culture, because you're trying to change the culture of an organization. But the first thing you need to also understand is the fact that if not now, when? This is basically Nigeria as a nation trying to expedite the inevitable. We cannot move forward without critical infrastructure. Infrastructure is a double coefficient of productivity. It's simple. If we don't have it, we don't create the jobs that we need. We don't move to the next level as a society. So even though the civil servants in the ministry might be a little
hesitant.
Yeah, absolutely. Mm. But we definitely have to find a way to work together, because the future of our nation is at stake. And the next generation will judge us based on what we do today. So it's critical to the future of diversification of the economy. And
so swim or sink. That's
absolutely
where we are. Again, yeah, because I'm just keeping thinking that if you look at it from what you've just said, it's beginning to look like money isn't really our problem.
No, money is not the problem.
Because we keep throwing billions and billions and trillions almost every year on capital projects,
yeah,
that hardly deliver, neither here nor there. So it's not just because there's no money, or that we have less money. We can always get money, because yeah, the money is sitting somewhere.
Absolutely. And the people who are disbursing this money, or who are making this money available, they are not saying they are not willing to give the money. The question is, do you have the right tools to take this money from us? And secondly, do you have reporting mechanisms? Do you have structures in place so that we can ensure that if we release this money to you, you will not probably, because in previous times, people have taken money and ministries have, I saw it on your program today, eating some of the monies in banks and stuff like that. So there is an issue of transparency. There is an issue of legal requirements that you have to meet. There is an issue of how we agree on this concession agreement and, you know, the legal side of things. So there are bits and pieces here and there that needs to be worked on. But I think this conversation is for a moment like this, where we all come together knowing fully well that we are going to sink. And if we don't do something immediately, the future is not guaranteed. But if we start moving in this direction, we can begin to salvage a future that our children and next generation will be proud of.
From a practical approach,
yes,
what will this conversation be? It's going to be an annual, so a bit of a conference together,
yeah,
to get the policymakers in the room. And yeah, I'm going to think that they are going to be the first guys who will need these tutorials.
Absolutely.
as it were, the deep pocket guys sitting in Frankfurt, in Singapore,
London,
whatever, in London, in
yeah,
China, they know what they want.
Absolutely.
So the parameters are very simple.
Yep.
So they're not going to unlock the vault if you don't come up with the right document.
Absolutely.
So what would you be telling them? What do you think, sitting them together, what are the critical few things they need to know?
Okay, so the first thing is, I've talked about the capacity issue. One of the beautiful things we are adding to this conversation is the deal room. The deal room for this year, we have $2.3 billion worth of transactions coming into our deal room. So, and this is for the for the European and American investors who are always saying, oh, we don't think deals are coming out of Nigeria. We are saying we have $2.3 billion worth of deals coming into the deal room, and it cuts across different sectors, from transportation to energy, from energy to some kind of fast-moving consumer goods. So we have all kinds of projects and transactions coming into the deal room. And that also speaks to our government or the policymakers to say, okay, from the public authority side, probably we have less than 20% of transactions that makes enough sense to get into the deal room. So majority of the transactions coming into the deal room this year is basically private sector driven transactions. The next step for us is to be able to tell the policymakers that our collaborative working going forward can increase the deal pipeline, and once the deal pipeline is increased, you can begin to attract more revenue for some of these big projects. So we're going to emphasize capacity building and how to work with them. We are also going to emphasize the question of not solving the problems of today, but also solving the problem that has a long-term horizon. And finally, we are also going to stress the fact that you don't need to own an asset. The most important thing is that the asset must make essential services available to your people. So whether you're structuring a deal and saying 40 years or 50 years, and then they return it to you, the most important thing is that that infrastructure asset is available and people can use its services.
Quite interesting scenario you've painted there, because the way we structure things in the budget annually is the government wants to own. So it's a third Milan Bridge, yes, it's owned by the government. The second Niger Bridge, it's owned by the government. It's also so highway, it's owned by the government. So this ownership mentality, rather than the projects delivering services, value, and it pays back.
As a matter of fact, one of the beauty of big ticket transactions, and that's why it's so crucial for Nigeria to start looking at that. Think about the Lagos-Calabar bridge that you just talked about, the possibility of that.
Of the highway.
Of that highway. Mm. I can see at least 40,000 jobs in building the highway. And then over the next 40 years, you can see the amount of jobs that you need to create to maintain that.
That corridor.
Absolutely. And you can then imagine the sub-businesses that come out of that. So we are talking about, and I try not to use the word trickle-down, but if trickle-down has ever worked, it will work in within the space of infrastructure financing, doing the big-ticket transactions in the right way, and ensuring that we are creating the jobs and the services that our people require.
You're a deal-maker, and you talk like someone who can make the $2.3 billion happen. Thank you very much for coming.
Thank you,
Bankole. Eniola, I need to get this right into my head. Bankole Eniola. Yeah, okay. Let us sink in. Do have a great weekend. And of course, if I have the time,
I'm going to
find time to see you guys. I'll talk to you guys and see how these deals are coming. But the sound of money and how it should work sounds very nice to me for what the policymakers should be the takeaway as to move Nigeria's infrastructure forward.